Sangeet Gulla sir, you are audible.
Audible, audible, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes,
yes
sir.
Sir,
Sangeet
yes,
Gulla
sir.
sir, you are audible.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, thank you. So let us start the second session for the day. The session topic is machine learning and image processing for cybersecurity. So we have with us an eminent speaker in this particular space. He has done a lot of work, Dr. J. Somshekar. I welcome Dr. Somshekar, the
Thank
resource
you, sir.
person
Thank
for
you.
This session, on behalf of ABBS Atal FTP team. Welcome, sir.
Thank
Dr. Somshekar,
are you able? Thank you, sir.
Okay, nice. Yeah, I take this opportunity to introduce the speaker of the session, Professor J. Somshekar, received a PhD degree in computer science and engineering from JNTUA, Andhra Pradesh, in the year 2017, and M.Tech degree from the National Institute of Karnataka, Suratkal, NIT K Suratkal, in 2010. He is currently working as professor and HOD at Computer Science and Engineering Department, Gopalan College of Engineering and Management, Bangalore. He is an active resource person for AICT FTPs, STTPs, short-term training programs, Atal FTPs, ISTE FTPs, national webinars, and has completed 45 sessions as a resource person across India, covering 7 states. He got an India rank of 43 in the GATE exam, Graduate Aptitude Test in Engineering exam, with 98.4 percentile. He has more than 14 years of experience in teaching and 6 years of experience in research. Besides, Professor Somshekar is a trainer for GATE exam since 2011. Professor Somshekar has published more than 25 research papers in leading journals, including SCI and Scopus indexed conference proceedings, and 2 international textbook chapters. He is having 152 citations with an high index 7 for his research publications. He is a reviewer for reputed international journals, Scopus, and international conferences, and session chair for 3 international conferences, and guest editor for 2 journals. He is also a visiting professor for PG course on data science at Government University in Kerala. He has also received Innovative Collaborative Researcher Award in Medical Imaging for research collaboration with Dr. Sing Hao Lei, Director, ITRI, Taiwan, by WRC in association with United Medical Council. Professor Somshekar has conducted various FTPs, AICT, STTPs, SDPs, national conferences, workshops, and national webinars as a convener and coordinator as well. His current research interests include image processing, machine learning, big data analytics, and ML for cyber security. With these few words, Professor Somshekar, your profile is really, you know, inspiring one.
Thank you, sir.
We are very fortunate to have you as a resource person for this important topic on machine learning and image processing for cyber security as part of AICTE Airtel FDP. With these few words, on behalf of Airtel FDP organizing committee at ABBS, I welcome the resource person Professor Somashekar to commence the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for introduction. I will share my PPT, sir. So are you able to see my screen, sir? Full screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Sir, if any disconnect in between during my presentation, please update, sir, because difficult to identify if some net issues. Yeah. So hope there is no issue going to happen. So thanks to organizers for the opportunity. So for AICTE Airtel FDP on applications of blockchain technology and artificial intelligence in the service sectors. So coming to my topic, so machine learning and image processing for cyber security. So obviously machine learning and image processing plays a vital role for the service sectors. So when you take, we have three main sectors. One is primary sector, one is secondary sector, one is service sector, or we can call it as a tertiary sector. And service sector contribution for our India GDP is 61%, around 61.5. So that means service sector plays a vital role for the contribution of the GDP of the country. So obviously the theme of the FDP is very suitable for the topic of machine learning and image processing. And in service sector, we have various domains like health domain or maybe health sector and computer services and media, communication and entertainment like movies, etc., banks, hotels, real estate, etc. All those things comes under service sector. And obviously there is a huge number of applications of machine learning and image processing for the service sector. So today we are going to discuss how machine learning is going to help for cyber security, and similarly how image processing plays a role for cyber security. Obviously both are a little bit different topics, because we know just machine learning, just image processing, but how is going to apply for cyber security is a little bit interesting domain. Even we have very, very less number of resources for this machine learning for cyber security and image processing for cyber security. Even we are not able to find even more than 2-3 textbooks. Even I used to do some research before giving any seminar or any presentation, but I used to find very less number of resources for this topic also. But it's very interesting topic and very, very useful, not only for cyber security, even for other applications also. So with this brief introduction, now I will move to the agenda. Of course, before going to agenda, I have one quick poll that is done recently, one of the international webinar. So you can see the question: do you think artificial intelligence and machine learning drastically change your security model in the next 5 years? So the answer for this poll in the international webinar, yes. So 56% major change. Obviously, there is a huge change going to happen in the security model because of artificial intelligence models or maybe machine learning models. Obviously, machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. So we are talking about machine learning. So obviously, around 60% of the what we can call it as a participants voted for there is a major change in the security model because of AI/ML. Obviously, even according to the recent Capgemini report, by 2025, so more than 70% of the companies depends on artificial intelligence and machine learning expert for cyber security models. So by using these machine learning models, so we can protect the data more accurate when compared to the present scenario. So that's why there is a huge demand in future also for machine learning experts or artificial intelligence experts, or we can call it as a data scientist. So because of that reason, so nowadays we have new courses also, artificial intelligence, machine learning, cyber security, data science, like there's so many courses introduced by AICTE also under graduation level. Of course, master level we have previously, but even graduation level only they are bringing the specialization instead of general computer science. So that's why there is a huge change going to happen because of AI and ML models in the future for security model. Even if you take even service sectors also like healthcare, bank, retail, and education, or maybe entertainment. Obviously, if we take entertainment, now we have OTT platforms everywhere because of pandemic. So everywhere we have OTT platforms, there we used to watch the movies. There we are getting recommendation of movies. Maybe if you take YouTube also, every day we used to get recommendation. Or if you take e-commerce website like Amazon, etc., there also we are getting everyday recommendation of mobiles or maybe textbooks or maybe other materials, etc., because of this machine learning models only. So of course, that is an entirely different topic when you come to the recommendation system. But there we are applying machine learning models. So by using that, we are getting this much recommendations day to day life. That's why we are being influenced with these machine learning models day to day life. Maybe we don't know what is exactly happening in the beyond. But whenever if we get recommendation in YouTube or maybe Facebook, etc., because of machine learning models only, or because of machine learning algorithms. So that is the solution for the quick poll. Now we will move to the agenda of today's session. So first we will see introduction of machine learning. What is machine learning? I'm not going to in depth of the machine learning. Just I'll give brief idea. Even though you are beginner, you are able to understand what is machine learning. After that, what is cybersecurity? Just I will give introduction. What is cybersecurity and why we require cybersecurity, or what is the need for cybersecurity in the present scenario for service sector? And Bayes and classifier for IDS, intrusion detection system. So that is actual cybersecurity and how we are applying machine learning for intrusion detection system. I will explain what is intrusion detection system and how we are going to classify by using machine learning models and with case studies, and even I will show data set also. And if you are anyone interesting to do research, you can download from that respective website and you can start the work. And I will give complete mathematical intuition, exactly what is happening in the mathematical intuition. I'm not doing this. This is a formula and you can apply like that. I will show what is the intuition beyond that model, and based on that, how we are going to apply for the cybersecurity application. Not only for cybersecurity application, even for other service sectors like healthcare or maybe retail, or it may be bank sector, or it may be entertainment. There also we can apply same model. Only thing is data set is different. That means if you know the intuition of the model, we can apply for any application. Here we are talking about cybersecurity. Maybe you can go for any other service sectors also. You can apply same model. Only thing is data set.
So we cannot listen to you, sir. No voice.
Dr. Jay Somshekar, you are not audible, sir. Dr. Jay Somshekar, you are not audible. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes. Hello. Yes.
Yes, sir.
You are not.
I don't know. Some net issue is disconnected. This is a problem when you come to the technical issues.
Now, can you see my full screen, sir?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, sir. Yeah. So I think. I gave introduction. So I already discussed machine learning, cybersecurity, and next Bayes and classifier intrusion detection system and regression model for cybersecurity and image processing for cybersecurity. So how we are going to apply image processing for cybersecurity applications? Not only for cybersecurity. If we take other service sectors like healthcare, etc. Also, we can apply image processing. There are huge number of applications, but today we are going to focus for cybersecurity application. And also, I will give some of the resources for this cybersecurity for service sector. I mean, machine learning for cybersecurity and machine learning for image processing. All those things I will give for resources also. Some textbooks are available, but very less number of textbooks are available for ML for cybersecurity and image for cybersecurity. So with this agenda, I'll move to the introduction of machine learning. So whenever if I take a human, so we can learn everything based on the experience. If you take here, if you take this diagram, we can understand clearly. So when you take human, we can get the knowledge based on the experience, or we can learn based on the experience. What about the machine? Whether machine can learn automatically? Yes, machine also can learn. So based on that data, instead of experiences, machine can learn from the data. That's why data is a huge demand nowadays. Everywhere we have, if you take organizations or maybe academia, everywhere we have huge data. So that's why if you want to do processing, obviously we require some machine learning algorithms. Based on that, we can go for more accurately, because human being difficult to do. Or if I take, I can't do lakhs of data records within 1 hour or maybe within half an hour for processing. If you take machine, within seconds, it will process and it will produce the output. So that's why machine learning comes to the picture. So when data is increasing, every day data is increasing, the volume become very big day by day. Because of that reason, machine learning applications also every day increasing. So that's why there is a huge demand in future also for machine learning applications. So now coming to the definition. So what it will do, machine learning is a tool which extract the knowledge or pattern from the data. It will extract all the features from the data, and based on that, it will go for prediction or it may be classification. So far, we don't know what is classification, all those things. So that we will see in detail. But the basic idea is it will predict the future value. Suppose I want to predict what is the rainfall tomorrow, or I want to predict how many number of COVID cases tomorrow, or I want to predict how many number of COVID deaths tomorrow. So like that. Or maybe if you have a data group of data, I want to classify. So first class students, second class students. So that comes under classification. So these two things we are going to do by using machine learning models. And same thing we are going to apply for cybersecurity application also. So that's why here data is very, very important. That's why data is just like a fuel. So that drives the machine learning engine. Without data, there is no use of applying machine learning models. So that's why data is very, very important. So once if we have a data properly, that means pre-processed data, then we can apply machine learning models. And based on that, we can go for accurate results. Now, when you come to how it is different from the traditional programming. So whenever if I take, let us assume C programming or C++ or etc. So what we have to do is, suppose let us assume I have to find sum of two numbers. Let us assume C equal to A plus B. So here I have to give input A equal to 2. Let us assume B equal to 3. So after A, we have to write the program scanf A comma B, C equal to A comma, A plus B, printf C value. Then you'll get output as a 5. 2 plus 3, 5. This is a traditional programming. So data we have to write. This is the data, and we have to write a program by using any programming language. So let us assume we have to use C language. We have to print the C value. Now, after executing this, we'll get output. Output is nothing but 5. This is the traditional programming what we are using, C, C++, etc. So, but when you come to the machine learning, how it will different? So that means in traditional programming, data as well as program is input for the computer system, and it will generate the output, that is the 2 plus 3 5, even if you take any other applications also. But when you come to the machine learning, so we have a data as well as output for input to the computer system, then it will make a program. Program is nothing but model here. So after making a model, by using this model we can predict the future value. So that means here we have a data is input, even output also input for the computer system, and after learning you will get a model, or we can call it as a program, and based on this model or program we can go for classification or we can go for prediction. So what does it mean actually? So let us assume, I will show one example, you can understand exactly what is the meaning. Suppose if I take this COVID-19 data set, so this is the data we have, data set we have 9 patients, 1 to 9, and this is called patient health record. So each patient health record I have, maybe what are the symptoms or features, and we have output also. What is the output?
Professor, yes. Sorry for the interruption. Your slides are changing.
Oh, not changing. Now, which slide are you able?
It is changing for me. I don't have an issue.
So Sir, I have, oh, are you able to see COVID-19 data set?
Yes, sir, we can, sir.
Yes, I am able to see. Yes.
Are you able to see
COVID? Yes, we are seeing, sir. Yes. We are getting it.
Okay, fine. Maybe network issues. So check it, sir.
No, sir.
Now, if you take here.
Same agenda.
No, sir.
No, it is actually hanging, holding in the agenda slide only.
We are getting the
otherwise
slides all, again, Abhishek, all the slides, but might be having a problem from your side, sir.
So, can I share once again, sir? Otherwise, I will stop sharing. Yeah, can I share once again?
Yeah, please, sir, please, because we are recording.
Yeah. Are you able to see now, sir, how ML is different slide?
No.
Yes, yes, sir, yes.
There. Yes, I am able to see.
Sir, even I am not getting.
Yes, we are able to see.
Okay, what I'll do, I'll just now log out again and log in.
Yes, yes, okay. Yes, professor. Yes, professor. That will work. But,
can I proceed, sir? Can I proceed, sir? Hello, sir. Sir, can I proceed or can I wait, sir?
Somasekhar, sir. Sir is out now. So he is not there in the meeting.
Okay. Sir, can I start, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead, professor. Please go ahead. I'll adjust myself this side. Please go ahead.
Okay. Then I'll continue, sir. Okay. Yeah. So just now I explained what is the difference between traditional programming and machine learning. In traditional programming, so we have to give input as well as we have to write output to the, then you will get output like a C equal to A plus B, 5 plus 2, 7, like that output. But when you come to the machine learning, we have to give input. So input means these are the features, or we can call it as symptoms of the patient, and this is the output. So output also we have to give. So like class of COVID-19, so negative, positive, like that. So that means this is the input and this is the output. So both we have to give to the computer system, then it will make a model. By using that model, I have to predict the future value. Future value means any new patient coming for testing, whether he is having COVID positive or negative with these symptoms. Let us assume he is having these symptoms. Let us assume chest pain, dry cough, loss of speech, etc. And when I give this input to the model, it will detect automatically whether he is having positive or negative. Let us assume positive or maybe negative. So this is the machine learning model. That means here the basic idea is we have to make a model by learning the data. That means data set. After that, we have to make a model, and that model will predict the future value. Future value means the whatever data available. So this data we have to give input, then based on that we can get output. Not only for this healthcare application, even if we take weather forecasting, or maybe I want to predict how many number of COVID cases tomorrow, maybe 10 or 20, that I have to predict for taking proper action. Or maybe how many COVID number of deaths possible tomorrow, that I have to predict based on that immediate precautions. So such type of applications, so machine learning plays a vital role. That's why nowadays everywhere we are applying machine learning algorithm for this type of prediction or for this type of classification. Even we can make a model in such a way that based on today's number of participants for this FDP and based on previous day, we can predict how many number of participants possibly to join tomorrow session. Like that, we can predict based on that organizers can do proper arrangement. So this type of prediction we can make because of machine learning models. So that's why it plays a vital role nowadays. So not only for that, we have so many other applications also. So in cyber security, that also we discuss. So I think it's clear the difference between so traditional programming and machine learning, and what is the major difference and why machine learning comes to the picture, because when the data issues nowadays, that's why big data era now we have. Now this is a basic machine learning model. So we have a data, data means here data set, and we have to go for training data. That means learning phase, this is called learning phase. So after that, once if we train, then it will make a model. That means it will make a program, we can call it as a program. And for this program, we have to give test data or maybe new data, then we have to evaluate the accuracy. If the accuracy is satisfiable, let us assume the accuracy is 99% by using some of the evaluation metrics, then we can deploy for the application. Let us assume if we want to make a model for COVID-19 detection, and after testing the data, the accuracy is 99%, then I can deploy for the respective hospital. Let us assume name of the hospital is XYZ. So then I can deploy that application to the hospital. And whenever new patient coming, I can apply this model. Within seconds, I can predict whether he's having or whether the patient having COVID positive or negative. So that's why always we have to make a learning the data. After that, it will make a model, and based on that model, we have to evaluate. Evaluation is very, very important. So we have to see evaluation. If the percentage is very less, that means accuracy, we have to again look forward, and we have to train maybe with other model, or maybe we have to tune the parameters, and based on that we have to increase the accuracy. So once if everything is satisfied, then we can go for deploy to the application, and then we can go for new data prediction for the given model. And here, what are the applications of machine learning? So we have so many applications because we are talking about service sector. So in service sector, we have so many applications here like healthcare. So medical diagnosis, just now I gave example, medical diagnosis, and we have image professor, recognition. Yes,
professor,
sir.
Professor, once again, just if you don't mind, can you just stop sharing? Again, can you put the sharing mode? Because we are not myself in our control room IT side also, they are not able to see anything. Since we are recording the session,
I'm able to see, sir. Dr. Singhutula, I am able to see. My name is Shankar. I don't know, maybe it is viewable to some. I think so, sir. I'm not sure for everybody.
Even cannot
vouch for
no, sir. No, sir.
Cannot vouch for everybody.
It's visible for us.
Visible for some, it is visible.
Yeah, it's visible to me also.
Just you can stop sharing.
Okay, sir.
And come out and again. No,
only the agenda slide is visible, the very first slide.
No, madam, no, even I'm not able to see that. I also logged out and logged in again. I left the meeting again, joined. Even I am not able to see the agenda. Our control room people also, they are not able to see anything. Since we are recording, recording is going on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You have to, I guess, stop sharing and restart sharing. Yes, yeah. That will be.
Sir, are you able to see, sir? Now,
just let us give me a minute because it is blinking now.
Ladies, close.
So now I am in 9th slide, sir.
Yeah, you are on slide number 9.
I am only getting D.
Yes, sir.
That label D only I am getting.
Same is the case here, sir. I am Lakshmi.
Agenda slides.
I don't know where is the problem. Because there is no network issues. Everything is fine. Huh?
So I am getting it.
Even other participants also able to see them.
That's what I could see the chat box. Yeah. So some are there already in a posted their messages.
Yeah.
Not so visible. Visible.
Applications of machine learning slide.
Yeah, we are in the applications of machine learning.
Yes.
No, our team, they are not able to get anything actually. It's still, you know, it is the opening screen only. I don't know what is the problem, I'm not able to understand. Everything is fine.
Sir, actually, I'm using web browser, sir, not app. Web browser I'm using.
In the web browser, not in the front application.
No, I am actually using my laptop only. I'm not using my mobile device, sir. Laptop only.
Okay. Join from Google Chrome, sir. Please join from
Google Chrome, sir.
Yeah.
Are you able to see that?
Yes, we can see it. The slides are open. The presentation is not open. The slides are open. Applications of machine learning is a slide which we can see.
Just to give half a minute, sir. Half a minute, so that you know. I'm only trying to
now
understand.
Now, can you see the slide name, sir? Sir, any other participants? I changed the slide. What is the slide, sir? Can you run?
Main types.
This is actually classification problem and main types.
Yeah, correct, sir. It's moving. It's visible, sir, properly.
Classification problem and
main types.
Sir, please join from the browser.
Google Chrome, sir.
Yes, sir.
This is not from.
From Microsoft Teams, it is not visible. Join from the browser, then it is visible. Now it is cybercrime there. Yeah, yes, I think you stop.
Now what I will do, sir? Otherwise, I will join Google Chrome, sir.
I think that is better, I believe, because the entire team actually they are standing in front of me.
Okay.
We are supposed to record the entire thing, no, and we have to upload on AICT portal as part of the documents.
Sir, otherwise, anyhow, I am organizer. Even I can record, no, sir, here.
No, this is actually directly connected with our IT system.
Okay.
And session-wise, no. See, after completing 14 sessions, if you don't name it properly, then finally, no, we'll end up with a confusion stage.
Yeah. Sir, 1 second, I will start in Google Chrome, sir, otherwise.
Please, sir, please. I think that could be better. But till now, no. Today, actually, we are on the 7th session. Yeah, 8th session. It was actually 8th session. Yeah, at least I have not faced any problem till now. Should I leave the meeting once I join? Professor? Also got disconnected. Huh? Professor Somashekar? Just 1 second.
Morning. Ask Naresh, he has Google Pay or what? Ask him.
Professor,
Professor Somashekar? Professor Somashekar? Professor Somashekar? Am I audible?
Yes, audible, sir.
Yes, Professor, you are audible.
Yeah, Professor Somashekar, can you start sharing? Kindly start sharing your PPTs.
This is okay now.
So are you able to see now, sir?
Just share your PPTs.
Yeah, already shared, sir.
Yeah, it is shared. The slide is again applications of machine learning, slide number 9.
Yes, sir, correct only. Now I am using Google Chrome, sir.
Otherwise, share the PPT, sir. We can see that we are not able to see.
Now I am using Google Chrome, madam. Previously, browser.
I am not getting. Professor?
Yes, sir.
Professor Somashekar? Yeah, because I don't want to waste your time.
Yes.
Even if I don't get the slides, okay, no problem. Anyway, you are going to share with me. Fortunately, you know, our control room, you know, they got the thing. Okay, they'll be recording.
Now they are getting, sir.
They are getting, but I am not able to get, no problem. After the session, I'll see what is to be done. You can go ahead. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Can you hear me, sir, my voice at least?
Yeah. Voice, absolutely no problem. You can go ahead, please.
Okay. Yeah. So coming to the applications, so we have so many applications of machine learning. So if you take medical diagnosis, that is healthcare application, and that comes under service sector. And if you take stock market trading, this is also comes under service sector. Even online fraud detection, this is also comes under service sector, that is cybersecurity application, and virtual personal assistant, and email spam detection, this is also cyber terrorism, that comes under cybersecurity, that I'll explain when you come to the future slide. And self-driving, this is not service sector. And product recommendations, this comes under e-commerce. And when you come to the entertainment, movie recommendations, all those things comes under here. That is also one of the applications of service sector. And traffic prediction, speech recognition, image recognition. Of course, image recognition also we can use for healthcare applications for detecting the disease or maybe segmentation, etc. And automatic language translation. So like that, we have so many applications of the machine learning, out of which we can see so many applications for service sector itself. So leave it other sectors, but we are talking about service sectors. We have these many applications in service sector. So, but today we are going to talk about how these machine learning models will help our cybersecurity applications. And based on that, what we are going to do, that we will discuss in detail. Even email spam detection also, I'll explain clearly. So medical diagnosis, of course, I gave just small example, COVID-19, but that also I'll explain by using some of the machine learning models. So with these brief applications, we will see at least a few applications of machine learning, which are applicable to the cybersecurity. Of course, healthcare also, it is applicable by using same model. And these are the machine learning algorithms. So we are focusing mainly supervised learning. We have unsupervised learning. I'll explain what is the meaning. And supervised learning and reinforcement learning. These are the main types of algorithms under machine learning, or we can call it as a types of machine learning problems. And I'll explain what is supervised, what is unsupervised, and what is reinforcement. So first of all, what is classification? So in general, when you take a class, it's very simple. We have a group of students. if you want to classify, so failed student, positive student. So let us assume we have a class group of students. I want to classify these are all failed students and these are all positive students. This is called binary classification. So just true or false, either pass or fail in the examination. This is one type of classification. Or maybe if I want to classify, let us assume dysfunction students, first class students, second class student, third class student, failed student. So this is called categorical classification. So we have, these are the categories. That's why we can call it as a categorical classification. Binary classification means either true or false. So categorical classification is based on the category we have to classify. We have more than one classification. I mean more than two categories, like a dysfunction, first class, second class, third class, fail. Like that we are, maybe we can expect, we can go for malpractice or maybe detained, etc. Like that we can go for different classifications. That is called categorical classifications. So for cybersecurity applications, we can go for binary classification, depends on the application, or you can go for a categorical classification. So for example, if you take binary application, so whenever if you go for intrusion detection system, so in the network system, whatever data we are receiving, we can classify whether the data is malicious or benign, whether the data is good or bad. That is the binary classification. So whenever if you take your system every day in the network traffic, we are getting a lot of data. So we have to classify which is the good data, which is the bad data. So bad data will affect your organization or maybe your system or maybe server, etc. So like that, even if you take different types of attacks, maybe let us assume if you have 10 types of attacks, then we can go for categorical classification. So whatever model we are going to develop in today's session, that we can apply for either categorical data or binary classification. So both are applicable. So that we will see later. So that is a classification. It is a process of categorizing a given set of data into classes. So let us assume if you take here, so we have three fruits. One is apple, one is orange, one is banana. So I have to make three classes. Whenever if I give new data, I have to classify whether the new fruit is either apple or banana or orange. Maybe here we have three classes. Banana is one class, orange is one class, and apple is one class. So we can perform this classification for structured data or unstructured data. So structured data means in the form of tables. Let us assume we have a table, like we have different features along with the class, or we can call it as an output. Just now I shown one COVID-19 application data set. So based on that, we can go for classification or unstructured data. Unstructured data means images, videos, etc. If we take any medical image, let us assume we have a chest X-ray image, let us assume CT image. So we have to classify whether the chest X-ray image having a cancer or not, or maybe malaria or not, or maybe COVID-19 or not. Like that, we can classify either a data set which is having rows and columns like matrix form. And maybe we can go for unstructured data. If you take images based on the image, I can go for classification. If you take this image only, let us assume here. So this is the image. If I give input, so I have to classify whenever if I give new fruit, I have to classify whether banana or orange or maybe apple. So that's why we are going to do for both structured and unstructured data. But when you come to the cybersecurity application, we are going to do only for structured data. So we are not going to use any images, just we are taking structured data. That means in terms of rows and columns, or we can call it as a tabular form. And after that, we are applying machine learning models. And based on that, we are going to go for classification or prediction. Now we have a classification problem mathematically. It's a very simple function. What is the mathematical function here? F maps D to C. So D is nothing but data set. So C is nothing but class. So meaning is, so let us assume we have different features. 1, 2, 3. Features are nothing but column headings or maybe attributes. So 1, 2, 3, these are the features, let us assume. And class is nothing but output, or we can call it as a label. So this is called output. So let us assume we have a data, some data, let us assume I already gave COVID application. Let us assume he is having fever. Let us assume maybe headache, etc. The class or C value is nothing but COVID positive. Or maybe one more record we have, and 1, 2, 3. One is nothing but fever, yes or no. A headache, yes or no. BP level, yes or no, like that. We have to go for classification negative. So that means for any record, if we take, there should be one output that is called class. So that's why it is a very simple function, fmaps D to C, where D is nothing but set of records, C is nothing but set of classes. If you take binary classification, we have two classes, true or false. If you take categorical classification, maybe we have more than two categories. I gave example for distinction, first class, etc. So that is the mathematical notation for classification. Theoretically, it is very simple, but when you go for research point of view, we have to write mathematical notations. So that's why it's very simple function f maps d2c. D is nothing but set of records, c is nothing but a class. Every record should associate with some class. That means it is a one-one mapping. And supervisor learning. Here, supervisor learning, what we have to do is, so you can see the image here. So we have a student and teacher. So teacher will explain all the instruction and student will learn the exam. That means we have some supervision and based on that, he will write the exam. Same thing here, when if I go for supervisor learning for classification. So we have all the records as well as class, that means output label. And this we have to train. And after that, we have to make a model that is called U. After making a model for new data, we can give to this model so that we can predict the future value. Just like function. For example, if we take, let us assume f of x equal to x plus 1. So this is called supervisor model. If I want to find f of 2 value, if I give x value is 2, what is the value? 2 plus 1, 3. So that is the output. Same thing here, when you come to supervisor model, whatever data set we have provided that we have set of records as well as output class also available. That means all the features or symptoms of the patient is available along with that class also available. That means whether he is having positive or negative COVID-19. So that is the input here. After making a training, we can make a model that is called U. Let us assume f of x. And after making a model, if you want to give new data in place of x, we can predict the future value. So that is called supervisor learning. So there we have supervision and based on that we can get the model. When you come to the unsupervised learning, there is no class here. So that means C is missing here. You can see here. So whenever if I take this, C is missing here. There is no C. Just we have records like patient symptoms only I have. I don't know whether he's having positive or negative. Just we have to train the patient symptoms and based on that I have to make a model and based on that I have to predict the future value. So maybe for some applications, this is more accurate, but some applications it won't give much accuracy when compared to the supervisor class learning. But today's session scope is supervisor learning. Unsupervised, we are not going to touch. So especially we are talking about data sets for cybersecurity, especially for intrusion detection system. So I'll explain what is intrusion detection, all those things. So there we are applying supervisor learning. If you want to extend reinforcement learning, so there we have huge number of applications. There we have to go for trial and error method case. There we have agent. Whenever success, you will get some reward. Whenever there is a mistake, we'll get some penalty. Like that, we have to repeat the process until we get reward. Then we have to apply for the application. Anyhow, that is out of scope for our today's session. That is called reinforcement algorithm. And even unsupervised also, we are not going to apply for today's session. So we are going to focus mainly for supervisor learning and that we are going to apply for all the applications. What we are going to discuss in the today's session. So this is a mathematical notations for a classification problem, supervisor learning followed by unsupervised learning. So the blind indication is unsupervised, there is no output, supervised we have output. So that's why we can see here image also, just like self-study here, there is no teacher here. So that is called unsupervised. When you come to supervised, we have a teacher. So teacher giving training to the student, based on that we'll go for model. So that's why supervisor is more accurate for most of the applications. And we are going to focus on these two things for our cybersecurity applications. One is regression model. By using that, how we are going to find the CVSS score, and based on that, how we are going to identify the vulnerabilities of the system, and based on that, we can try to minimize the attack from the third person, or we can call it as intruders, or we can call it as hackers. So that is the regression concept we are going to apply for cybersecurity. And a classification, we are going to apply for intrusion detection classification. So whenever if you take any network system or a network, there is a huge number of data. Every day we are seeing, if you take our laptop only, every day we are getting huge number of data in the network. So we have to classify whether the data is a good data or bad data, whether malicious or benign. So that we are going to use by using supervisor learning. So these are the two things we are going to focus for. So machine learning for cybersecurity applications. Of course, other applications also I will tell you. And after that, we'll move to the image processing for cybersecurity. And with this introduction of machine learning, just I explained what is the definition of machine learning and what is the difference between traditional programming and machine learning and what are the applications with examples I gave. And also I gave what is supervisor classification and unsupervised classification, mathematical formulas, and we are going to apply for supervisor for cybersecurity. And with this brief introduction of machine learning, now we will move to the cybersecurity. At least we get some idea about machine learning. So based on that, we will see cybersecurity fundamentals. And after completing cybersecurity fundamentals, directly we will apply machine learning for cybersecurity applications. Now, whenever if I take cybersecurity, so it is a criminal activity, so that targets the computer or maybe computer network or maybe network device. So that's why whenever if I take here, let us assume if we take our system, someone can hack, or maybe if we take our college server, someone can hack the server so that they can extract the information or data from the server. So it leads to the data breaching. So obviously we are going to lose the data because of that reason. So we are going to lose the identity of the organization. At the same time, everything, it will go to the hacker's hand. Whatever he wants, he will do. So because of that reason, there's a huge loss for the organization or maybe company also. So that's why, so obviously the cybercrime is an activity done by using computers as well as internet. So especially if we take hacking or cyber terrorism. So cyber terrorism means email fraud. So we every day we are getting mails. Whenever if you take some mails, if you click the link, automatically our data breaching will do. That means automatically they will take our IDs like credit cards or maybe other card ID or maybe our passports, etc. They can take easily because of this type of cyber terrorism. So that's why whenever we are getting mail, automatically the machine learning will do the mail is spam or not spam. So whenever if you go to the spam, that is some type of junk mails, we can't touch that type of mails. Non-spam means, so obviously we can use for properly. So that's why machine learning plays a vital role. Now that also we will see how we are going to classify whether the mail is a spam or not spam. And software piracy and computer viruses, etc. So these are all comes under different types of cyber crimes. And here the cyber crimes can be computed as a target, like they can attack the computers directly with the help of virus or maybe hacking or maybe DOS attack, or maybe computer as a weapon. By using that, they will go for real world crimes like credit card fraud system, etc. So finally, they are going to extract the information from your system or maybe server or maybe network. So because of that reason, we are going to lose the identity, we are going to lose the data, and obviously it leads to the bad name for the organization, and we will lose a lot of revenue also. And these are the biggest cyber crimes, five cyber crimes. Of course, we have so many number of cyber crimes, like around 10 previously I used to give, but because of time factor, I'm showing these are the five biggest cyber crimes so far happened. If you take first one, 50 million credit cards data stolen from Home Depot system. So 50 million means you can imagine, 1 million means 10 lakhs. So 50 million credit cards they stolen, and after that they can go for whatever they want to do, they can do, and they will take the money from the all the credit cards also. So this happened. And second one is, so largest theft of customer data. So 76 million customer data. So that happened in 2014. So that is also one of the biggest cyber crime. And third one is Yahoo data breach. So over 1 billion users data was breached. So breaching data means, so we have to take the personal information of the customers. For example, if you take Ola or Uber, so we have, whenever if I create a Ola password or maybe Uber or maybe Gmail, etc., our personal information is available in the login credentials. So that type of data, if you want to store, I mean, if you want to stolen, that is called data breaching. So that type of thing happened when you go for Yahoo data breach, around 1 billion users data. So 1 billion users data, someone stolen. So that is happened 2013 to 2016. Even here also, 79 million customers data was stolen from healthcare companies. So obviously they can extract all the data from these healthcare companies. Maybe they can utilize for some other purpose. And same thing over 7 lakh social security numbers were stolen from IRS. So this is also happened 2015. So if you want in detail, you can go through here reference I given. So if you want inside what is exactly happened, all those things, that details, if you go inside, you can see, and what happened because of that reason for the companies, that also you can see, because all those things are difficult to explain. Just I'm showing what is the major drawback of the cyber crimes. And these are the facts and figures. So a cyber artificial intelligent market will reach around 30.9 billion by 2025. I already said there is a huge demand for data scientists for cyber security applications because of so many applications of machine learning models to the cyber security. So obviously by 2025, around 30.9 billion. So because of that reason only, so around 90% of the data scientists required for the cyber security applications, according to the Capgemini report also. And also Uber paid $148 million fine in 2018 to the US government due to data breach. So what happens, this Uber, so they stolen customers data. So because of that reason, maybe someone complained. So that's why they paid this much fine, $148 million. And if you take Huawei, was banned from selling its products in North America because it was alleged by spying. So that means they got information security from other companies, all those things, one type of data breach. So that is done by this company. That's why they banned this company in North America. So that means there is a serious issues because of this type of data breach or maybe hacking, all those things happening in the entire world. That's why they are taking serious punishment to the respective companies like Huawei and Uber, etc. also. And these are the impacted by the cyber crimes. So India comes to the 10th place. So rest of the countries, you can see USA is in the first place, 23%. And rest of the countries, you can see 1-2% like that. India comes to the third place. But in 2019, so around 3 months, we are in the top place because of the cyber attacks. So only 3 months after that, we come to the 10th place. So many people are attacking our Indian websites, etc. So that's why we are in the top place around 3 months in 2019. After that, we come down to the 10th place by taking proper cyber security measurements. And we have different types of attacks like malware attack and phishing attack and password attack. Like that, we have different types of attack. Whenever if I take hacker, so they will attack by using any one of these kind of attacks. For example, if you take malware, so this is just like software programs designed to damage on a computer. So for example, if you take virus, etc., these are all malware attacks. So directly if you inject virus, then obviously it will damage your system or maybe server, etc. So this type of attacks, we can call it as a malware. If you take phishing, this is one type of email attack. So they will send email. If you click the link, then you enter the personal details, then automatically it will go to that respective hacker. So this is called phishing. And password attacks, and some of the hackers can take your password and they can utilize, and based on that, they will extract the data from you. So like that, we have so many types of attacks based on this. So it may harm your system or maybe server or maybe network or maybe organization. So obviously, because of that reason, we are going to lose huge revenue. Now coming to the cybersecurity, why we require cybersecurity? So we know what is cybercrime. So any activity done by computer that is called cybercrime. We have different types of attacks. Because of these attacks, so we are going to lose huge amount of data as well as money also. Now how we are going to control this one? So cyber is nothing but it may be computer system or it may be program or it may be network or it may be data. So we have to protect the cyber. For that we require some security mechanism that we can call it as a system security or network security or program or data security. So for that we have to use cyber security tools. So we have various cyber security tools. By using that, we can protect our computer system, we can protect our program, we can protect our network, we can protect our data. So that's why cyber security comes to the picture. So that's why this comes under service sector only. So computers, all those things comes under service sectors only. So that's why cyber security plays a vital role. So suppose if we have hacker here, we have organization data, we'll try to minimize the attacking. So otherwise, if you don't have cyber security tools or maybe mechanism, obviously this person will attack the organization and he will steal all the information from the organization, and based on that we are going to lose huge amount of data. Suppose if we have cyber security mechanism, then we can try to minimize. So 100% not possible to stop this one attacking, but we'll try to minimize maximum. So based on that we will get the huge benefits. So that's why the definition is, so it is a body of technologies, process and practices to protect the networks or computers or programs or data from the attack or unauthorized access. So attacker, or maybe we can call it as intruders, or maybe unauthorized third person. So they are not able to access the data because of the cybersecurity tools or maybe mechanism. So that's why cybersecurity come to the picture. Now, these are the main goals of cybersecurity. One is integrity and confidentiality and availability. So confidentiality means, so if I'm sending one message to my friend, no one can see that message. So that's why unreadable for unauthorized users. Third person cannot see. That is called confidentiality. So that we can do by using cybersecurity mechanism. And integrity. So integrity means, so it is difficult to modify the message by the third person. Whenever if I take newspaper every day morning, if you are reading newspaper, so once if you done printing, no one can modify the data. Third person cannot access or cannot modify this data. So this type of thing we can comes under integrity and availability. So when you come to the availability, so authorized person only can update the data or can access the data or can modify the data. So third person or hacker cannot do. So these are the main goals of cybersecurity. Because of that reason only, so most of the organizations require cybersecurity professionals, and based on that we'll try to minimize this type of hacking. So but in today's session we will see confidentiality by using image processing applications, and integrity availability also we can see later. So this is the need for cybersecurity to protect private data, to protect intellectual data, and to protect banking financial data. Everywhere, if you take any organization or if you take any company or if you take any sector, it may be a private sector or public sector or service sector, we require cybersecurity mechanism or tools. Based on that, we'll try to protect data and maybe a computer or maybe network or maybe server, etc. So at least we'll protect. Instead of 100% hacking, we can try to protect 99%. We can protect. Maybe sometimes 110% also we can protect our data, maybe servers, etc. So with this cybersecurity introduction, now we will move to the main agenda. That is how we are going to apply machine learning for cybersecurity. Now it's clear what is machine learning and what are the types, and we know what is cyber crime and what is cybersecurity and what are the goals of cybersecurity. Now we will see how we are going to apply machine learning algorithms for cybersecurity. So first of all, why we have to use machine learning for cybersecurity? Because whenever if I take, we have huge data. If we take a network, let us assume if we take a network, every day we are getting huge amount of data. So let us assume, so we have a network here. We are receiving mails, we are receiving videos, we are receiving some other documents, we are receiving some unstructured data. Like that, we are receiving a lot of data. That means huge data. So to handle this data, obviously we require some machine learning algorithms. So that's why whenever data is more, obviously machine learning come to the picture. And we have to clean the data. Some data may be not up to the mark, or maybe some data is missing. So this type of thing, if you want to do, we have to go for machine learning algorithm, or maybe useful data. So this also we can identify based on the machine learning algorithm. So like that, we have different strategies. So these can achieve by using this machine learning algorithms or artificial algorithms. So based on that, we can go for more accurately detection of intruders attacking, or maybe data which is not up to the mark, or we can call it as a bad data. All those things we can detect easily. Now here our aim is to apply machine learning for our cybersecurity. So there we have an important topic that is called intrusion detection system. So what is the meaning of intrusion? So an unauthorized access is called intrusion. For example, I have a system, some unauthorized person accessing my system, that is called intrusion. So this intrusion can be done by intruders. That intruders may be inside the company or outside the organization. So we have two types of intruders. Intruders means unauthorized person. So this person may be from inside the organization or maybe outside the organization. So
rastri bhi laga hai, mota hai kapda.
Hello. Yeah, can you mute please? Thank you. So any unauthorized access is called intrusion. So this intrusion can be done by intruders. We can call it as a third person. So this person may be inside the organization, maybe outside the organization. That's why here you can see either outside intruders or inside intruders. Possibility is there. But how to identify for that? So for that, we have to go for intrusion detection system. So most of the organizations or most of the companies or most of the service sectors, etc., they have intrusion detection system. And this intrusion detection system will monitor the network traffic, because I already said, whenever if I take network traffic, every day we are receiving a lot of data. So maybe videos or maybe documents or maybe mails or maybe other messages or maybe unstructured data, etc. So maybe in that data, maybe possibility for maybe virus data or maybe some other vulnerabilities. Because of that reason, they may attack our organization data. This we have to monitor by using intrusion detection system. So it will monitor this network traffic, and whenever some bad signal is coming, immediately it will detect and it will give information to the system admin and he will take immediate action. Suppose if everything is good, there is no issue. If something is going bad, maybe a possibility for attacking the organization or maybe server, immediately intrusion detection system will give signal to the admin and admin will take care for rest of the steps. But the question is how to identify the signal is bad or not. So for that, we have to go for machine learning. So we have huge data coming. Let us assume like this is a network and lot of data coming towards the organization or maybe system or maybe server. So we have to classify whether the data is benign, that is good data, or malicious or bad data. So maybe any possibility for attack also. We have different types of attack, I already said briefly, not in depth. So maybe that type of attack also possible. That also we are possibility for classification. So based on this classification, if the classification is, let us assume, benign data, benign means good data, then no need to go for further step. Suppose the data is malicious, malicious means bad data. That means the network is bad, maybe whatever data receiving, immediately it will give the indication and based on that we'll go for further step. So this type of data identification or classification we can do with the help of machine learning algorithms. So that's why, so for cyber security we are applying machine learning algorithm for intrusion detection system. Like that we have different other applications also, but we are focusing this one. Even we have so many publications available for this intrusion detection system. So here I'm showing one sample publication, research publication. So Bayesian classifier based on intrusion detection system. So we know what is the meaning of intrusion, that is unauthorized access. Whenever we have unauthorized access, if you want to detect, for that we have to go for machine learning algorithms. So here I'm going to apply Bayesian classifier. So by using Bayesian classifier, that is called probabilistic classifier, we are going to detect whether the data what we are receiving is good data or bad data, or we can call it as a benign, or we can call it as a malicious. Benign means good, malicious means bad data. So this is a basic idea. This I am going to consider as a reference, and this I am going to explain in today's session how we are going to detect intrusion and based on the Bayesian classifier or Bayesian-based intrusion detection system. So up to here we completed all the basics or fundamentals. We know machine learning basics, we know cyber crimes, we know cyber security, why we require cyber security, and what is the intrusion and why we have to detect intrusion detection, and based on that we can try to minimize the attacking our server or maybe system or organization data. So for that we have to apply machine learning algorithms. So now we will see how we are going to apply Bayesian classifier for IDS, so that is called intrusion detection system. So here a given formula, no need to worry about this formula. I will explain in detail how we are going to apply. So here we require some basic probability. So just simple mathematics only. So here we know what is the probability. Probability means favorable cases by exhaust to number of cases. So for example, if you take, let us assume, so we have a data 50, 60, let us assume, or 20. So 50, just one minute, I'll try to complete these fundamentals. I mean probability 50, 20, and 60, this is the data I have, and here this student passed, this student passed, this student failed. Suppose if you want to find the probability, probability means possibility, because entire machine learning, data science, deep learning, artificial intelligence purely depends on mathematics only. If you are weak in mathematics, so my suggestion, try to go to mathematics, any textbooks like probability statistics or linear algebra, calculus or differential equation, try to learn properly, then you can come to the machine learning, deep learning, etc. Otherwise difficult to understand these mathematical notations and difficult to become a data scientist or difficult to go for publications also. Now here we have three students data, and total three. So out of three, how many students passed? Two. So this is the probability that a randomly student passed in the exam. Whenever if you want to select one student randomly, so what is the probability that he will pass in the exam is 2/3. So total number of students 3, and favorable number of cases passed in the exam is 2. So this student passed, this student passed. So 2/3 is the answer. So this is called basic probability. So favorable number of cases by exhaust number of cases. When you take conditional probability, we have to find based on the condition. So let us assume probability of what is the probability that a patient having COVID positive given that is having fever. So here condition is fever. What is the condition here? Fever. Based on this symptom, I have to identify whether the person having COVID positive or not. So if you don't have condition directly, I want to check whether the person having positive or not, then we don't have any condition. So it is difficult to find. Because of that reason, condition probability is very important. So based on the condition, we are going to find whether the person having COVID positive or not. So that's why conditional probability is very important for classification, and based on that we are going to extend for Bayesian classifier also. So that's why here we can see probability that a student passed in the exam, probability that a student passed in the exam, and what is the possibility that you'll get distinction. So that means the condition is you should pass in the exam, then only we have to look for distinction. So without passing in the exam, how can I check distinction? That's why first we have to see the condition pass, and based on that I'm looking for distinction. So this is called conditional probability. With condition I'm looking for probability, without condition I'm looking for probability, that is called general probability. Now when you come to the conditional, now I will show what is the intuition of Navier based classifier, or maybe Navier based classifier, and based on that how we are going to apply for our intuition detection system in the cyber security application. Not only for cyber security application, you can apply for healthcare application, or you can apply for any other application also, but same formula what I am going to explain, same formula copy paste, only thing is data set is different. For cyber security application I am assuming some cyber security as a IDS data set. If you go for healthcare related respective data set you can assume, or if you go for maybe recommendation system we can assume that recommendation data set. Like that data set is different but the model is same. Whatever model I am going to discuss here, same thing applicable for any application of the machine learning. When you go for classification, it may be binary classification or it may be categorical classification. I already told you what is the difference between binary classification and categorical classification also. Now here when you come to the conditional probability P of A given B, so this is a basic formula of conditional probability. Here you can see previous slide also, here I gave basic probability P of A intersection by P of A. What is the basic idea is, when you if I take conditional probability, intersection value we have to take as numerator, and condition is nothing but denominator. Entire condition we have to take it as a denominator. So that's why we can write like this. So whenever if I take, so P of X given Y, given Y means condition. Denominator is condition, numerator is probability what we are looking here. So denominator is this one, P of Y. So condition is nothing but denominator, and numerator is nothing but intersection value, X and Y. So X intersection Y. So if you want to understand, if you are trying to understand through Venn diagram, you can see here. So this intersection part comes to the numerator, and the entire x value comes to the entire y value comes to the denominator. Whatever denominator here, y, that comes under denominator. So that is the basic idea of conditional probability. We have to take P of Y as denominator, and numerator is in X intersection Y. Through this Venn diagram we can write, suppose if you are looking for P of Y given X, then numerator is same, intersection is same, but denominator will change. P of X instead of Y, if you want to make like this formula, so denominator becomes X. So in the entire X we are looking for possibility for Y, that's why we are part take it as a P of X intersection Y. So that's why here also you get P of X intersection Y divided by P of X. So we are taking entire X, after that we are looking for common value value of X and Y. That's why we are getting numerator is X intersection Y. Here you can see through example. So we are looking for distinction. We are looking for all the distinction students, and after that we are looking for distinction the past student. That means 80, 90. So that's why numerator is 2, intersection is 2, and denominator is all the students of denominator past. Past means all 4 students. That's why denominator is 4. So that's why P of A intersection by P of A. So that's why we can call it as a conditional probability. Now here the conditional probability of A given B is P of A intersection by P of B, just now I gave. And similarly the conditional probability of B given A is P of B intersection A by P of A. So this is the conditional probability for A given B. Given means condition, P of B given A. Now you know one logic, whenever if I take set theory what we studied in lower classes, so intersection of AB and is same as intersection of BA, same thing union also. So A union B is same as B union A. That's why we can call it as a AB equal to BA. So similarly A plus B equal to B plus A. By using that logic we are writing P of A intersection B equal to P of B intersection A. So this is the what we can call it as a property by using set theory, or maybe union also we can take, but we are talking about conditional probability. Numerator is intersection, that's why we are taking P of A intersection B equal to P of A intersection B intersection A. Now when you come to the left side you can take this one, so cross multiply, so that we'll get P of A given B into P of B. When you take P of A intersection B, when you cross multiply, P of A given B into P of B equal to, when you take second equation, so cross multiply, we'll get P of B given A equal to P of B intersection by P of A. After cross multiplying we'll get this value. So that means, so from first equation we are getting left side, from second equation we are getting right side. Nothing we are doing, just we are cross multiplying. If we cross multiply we will get B intersection A, if we cross multiply we will get P of A intersection B. And from this we are writing, so P of A given B equal to, just we are shifting this to right side, so that we'll get P of A given B equal to this formula. This is called Bayes theorem. That means the concept of this Bayes theorem is we are going to find the probability of A based on the condition B. So here P of A into P of B given A by P of B. So this is a Bayes theorem. This we derived by using conditional probability. Now finally we got Bayes theorem. Now how it is applicable for our data set? So B is nothing but future. That means whatever futures are available in the data set. A is nothing but class. Whatever class we are going to detect. That means it may be type of attack. What we have different types of attack that we are going to detect. That is called A. I'm looking for type 1 attack or I'm looking for type 2 attack. What is the probability? And based on that, how we are going to go for classification. So that's why denominator is now always symptom, or we can call it as a future, or we can call it as an attribute. Numerator is nothing but class, or we can call it as an output, or we can call it as a label, and that what we are going to predict. Now, when you come to the training data set, looks like this. So we have, I already said, we have structured data X1, X2. So this is the traffic, network traffic data. X1 means some value, X2 means some names are there. I will show that data set. And these are the records, R1 first. When you come to the 930, what is the network traffic data? When you come to the 935, second record, what is the network traffic data? When you come to the 940, what is the network traffic data? Like that, these are the records that are available. And this is the class. So class means we identified the network traffic is good. The network traffic is good. But here we identified there is an attack here. Maybe network traffic is good, but there is an attack here. Like that, we can classify, and based on that, we'll go for further action immediately. So that's why always the structured data set looks like this. So these are the futures, or we can call it as attribute. This is called class or label of the output class, or we can call it as an output, or we can call it as supervision. Technically speaking, we can call it as supervision. That is the final output. Suppose if we take our intuition detection system data set, looks like this. So if you want to download this data set, you can go to this machine learning repository UCI. So in Google, if you type machine learning repository UCI, you can find thousands of data sets. All are benchmark data sets. Why I'm telling benchmark data sets? So they've done most of the pre-processing for most of the data sets, and directly you can apply for the model. If the data is not benchmark data set, we have to do a lot of pre-processing. Maybe some data is missing, or maybe some labels are missing, or maybe some records are empty. So such type of data set if we have, then we have to do a lot of pre-processing, like cleaning data, or we have to go for filling the missing values. That is called exploratory data analysis, EDA. So in machine learning, we have a very important concept that is called exploratory data analysis. By using that, we can impute the values. Impute the values means some value is missing here. So maybe empty. These are the values empty. This we have to impute, or this we have to fill. For that, we have to go for exploratory data analysis. There we have different types of algorithms. By using that, we have to apply. But it will take a lengthy process. That's why if we go for benchmark data sets, no need to do this type of pre-processing. Directly, we can apply our model. So when you go for machine learning repository, there we can find benchmark data sets, and that we can download free of cost only, open source only. You can download, you can apply for your research work, or maybe your publication work, or maybe for your project also. So when you come to the cybersecurity application, what we are discussing here, I already said what is the meaning of intrusion, unauthorized access. So this we are going to do detection. That's why we intrusion detection system comes to the picture. And whenever if you go for machine learning, so by using machine learning classification techniques, we are going to do intrusion detection system. Whenever some data is received through network traffic or maybe network, we can identify, is there any attack is possibility is there? If so, then the attack is malicious. If not, there is no attack, the data is very good like that. So for that type of classification or categorical classification, or it may be binary classification, so we have to apply Bayesian classifier, just know what we discussed, the formulas that we are going to apply. Here you can see there are 41 futures. So I'm not showing all the futures. Maybe it is difficult to understand these futures in detail. That's why if you download, if you do some literature, then you can understand these futures. But time being, I'm assuming X1, X2, X3, X4, X5 like that. So there are 41 columns, or we can call it as a 41 attributes. So, and we have one responsible variable. Responsible variable means supervision, or we can call it as an output. So let us assume, if we take, let us assume record number 2 here. So the output is normal. The data what we received here, some values are given for data received in the network. So there the data is normal. Maybe if we take, let us assume here, when you take this data, record number 13.
I got a question.
When you take the record. Yeah, yeah. Tell me, sir.
If you increase the dependent variables, that means that yes, you are increasing the classification. And
No. Actually, understood. I got your point, sir. The dependent variable is always one only. You are talking about this label is always one, but the values for these variables may be two or more than two. Suppose if you take binary classification, the value of x, the value of label is only 0 and 1. If we take categorical classification, the value of the variable x is 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. Depends on the application, the values are different. But here we have different types of attacks, that's why we have normal.
Hello, sir. My question is, if you increase the dependent variables more and more, then how can we get the accurate results in the closed loop?
No, but same model we are going to apply. Yeah, I got the point. Whatever number of variables we are in, the values of the dependent variable, if increase also no issue, we are going to apply model for same thing. Like we are assuming, let us assume C1, C2, C3, different classes we are assuming. For all the classes, we are going to apply probability. I will show that examples are still not completed. So far, just we completed introduction of Bayesian classifier, still not even applied for any data set. Next slide, it will come to the picture, sir. I will explain there. So here I'm taking C1, C2 for the label. If you want to go for C1, C2, C3, C4 also fine. There is no issue. We have to find all the probabilities, and after that we have to see the best probability or maximum probability. Based on that, we can go for classification. So there is no issue. Whatever number of variables for the dependent variable, there is no issue. But only thing is, we have to find the more probability values. Binary means only two probabilities we calculate, then we will get directly output. Otherwise, we have to go for more probabilities. So that anyhow, still not completed. Next slide, you'll get that the calculations and how we are going to apply for our data set, I'll explain. So there you'll get still more clarity. After that, still not able to understand, I'll explain. So once again. So here we have labeled so many values for this label. Obviously, we have always one output only. So normal, or maybe Neptune attack. Like that, we have different types of attack here. If we open this data set, you can find. That's why in free time, you can go through this website and you can download the Excel sheet only. So you can find around 10 or more than 10 types of categorical values here. Depends on the data. So, and records also, maybe you can find around 20,000 rows. That means 20,000 records you can find in that Excel. Just I'm showing screenshot of first 26 records only. That is called KDD Cup 99 dataset. And if you want to see more, you have to download. You can go through that. You can identify. Now, my intention for showing this. So how we are going to apply for Bayes theorem for this type of dataset, and what type of result we are going to get, that we will see in the further slide. So now we know clearly what is Bayes theorem. So we completed just how we got Bayes theorem. This is the Bayes theorem. But how we are going to apply for our data set? What we discussed just now in data set, we have different futures like x1, x2, so on, xn. And these are all independent futures. And last one is dependent. That is called class, or we can call it as an output. So whenever if I take output, obviously we have different values for output. It may be categorical values. But how we are going to apply for our Bayes theorem? So what we have to do is, so future vector, or we can call it as a dependent vector, x equal to x1, x2, so on, xn. So that is, these are nothing but first column, second column, third column, nth column. And class is nothing but y, that is the last column. You can see here, so these are all x1, x2, so on. So we have 41 xn values up to x1 to x41, and y is nothing but dependent variable, that is called output value or label. So same thing here, I am assuming generalization x1 to xn, and output class is y. Now I am in place of A, I am assuming class, that is called output. In place of B, I am assuming futures. So the classic example I will tell you here, you can understand. Probability of, I want to classify whether the person having disease is positive or not based on the futures. Let us assume fever, let us assume cold, let us assume headache, let us assume leg pain. So this probability I want to find. What is the probability that a person having COVID positive based on the futures, or we can call it as a independent variables like fever, chest pain, headache, and leg pain. Same thing here. Denominator is nothing but all the futures of the individual detection system data set. So x1, x2, xn. Please mute the... So here the class is why, that is called, we have to identify what type of attack, whether normal attack or maybe any other type of attack that we are going to find here. So now what we have to do, Bayes theorem, numerator replaced by y and denominator replaced by x. X is nothing but x1, x2, so on, xn. These are the futures, and y is nothing but class what we are looking. That class may be either binary or categorical values. So we may be different types of attacks also possible. Now we have to apply Bayes theorem, numerator. So P of A, P of M is P of y, and P of B given A. In place of B, we have x1, x2, so on, xn. So that's why P of x1 given y, x2.
Every time capital Y is going to be one single.
No, no, capital Y can take either 0, 1, or it may be categorical value, C1, C2, C3, etc.
Because you have taken
Y value can be either. Yeah, I will tell you that. I'll come to you. Here. You can see here, I'm highlighting here. This Y may be C1, Y may be C2, Y can be C3 also. You got it, sir, here, right side.
Yes, yes, sir.
Y can take any value, it may be binary. Yeah, yeah.
That's why I'm asking.
This Y can be okay. Thank you.
Why
this binary?
Why is?
So here I'm writing according to your doubt. So if we take binary classification, Y equal to C1, C2. If we take categorical classification, Y equal to C1, C2, so on, Cn. Now you got it, sir.
Okay.
Is it clear, sir? Yeah. So, but we are going to talk about binary for next example. So that's why we are taking C1, C2. If you are looking for more values output, let us assume, I said already, distinction first class, second class for classification of the student, then Y can be either distinction or first class or second class or fail or maybe malpractice. All the probabilities we have to evaluate. So anyhow, numeric example case study, I'll do next slide. So now what we have to do here, numerator. So we have to replace the numerator value with this formula. So P of y into P of x1 given y, because of independent nature, all the futures are independent. Whenever if we have independent, we can go for independent events probability. So whenever if I take two events are independent, P of AB equal to P of A into P of B. This is the basic formula for independent events, or we can call it as independent futures. So this can be written as, so P of A into P of B. So by using this logic, I'm writing numerator P of x1 given y into P of x2 given y, etc. So on. So now numerator can be written as product of P of xi given y. Now, whenever if I take denominator, it is constant for all the probabilities, whatever class if we take. So either y can be C1, y can be C2, y can be C3, whatever y value if we take, denominator is constant. There is no change in the denominator. So because of that reason, it won't show much effect if you remove for the classification. Unnecessarily, time complexity will become more. That's why I'm going to neglect this denominator. So that's why I'm going to consider this one. If we include also nothing, we are going to lose. You can see here, right side. So whenever if I take class is C1, denominator is P of X1, X2. Whenever if I take class is C2, denominator is P of X1, X2, so on, Xn. Whenever if I take class C3, denominator is same. So that means, so denominator is common for all the class probabilities. Because of that reason, we can remove directly. If we consider also, you are not going to lose anything, but unnecessarily computation becomes more. So because of that reason, time complexity become more. Because of that reason, so we are going to remove denominator. So finally, we are getting Bayesian classifier, P of y given x equal to P of y into product of P of x given y. So y is nothing but class. It may be C1, C2, or it may be C1, C2, C3 for category classification. Now, finally, we done intuition of Bayesian classifier. Now, how to apply for our data set? That is our main intention. I think it's clear. If any doubt, this derivation part, you can ask me, because this is very important, not only for cybersecurity application. You can apply for healthcare applications. You can apply for any other service sector applications, or maybe recommendation systems, etc. also. Now we are going to apply for this Bayesian classifier.
Sir, you wanted to mute. Dr. Somsekhar, you are in mute, sir.
No, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. Can you hear
me, sir?
Now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, whenever if I take here, we have to find the maximum probability and corresponding to which class, that is called argmax. Argmax is nothing but the maximum probability corresponding to which class is nothing but argmax. So, when you take here maximum probability 0.57 corresponding to the class 2, so that's why the classification is nothing but benign. That means the attack is normal attack. So for that directly we can classify the classification is benign. So why I given here means, so what is the meaning of argmax? Max is nothing but maximum value. Argmax is nothing but maximum value corresponding to which class, that is important. So maximum value 0.57, which corresponding to which class? Benign. That means normal attack. So that's why the classification is benign. So that is the meaning of argmax, followed by probability what we calculated just now. Now this is the classification process. So we have a new data, and by using a naive Bayes classifier, what we done just now, intuition, mathematical intuition that we have to apply, and based on that we can go for class, whichever it may be application. So based on that we can go for class. So it may be binary classification or it may be categorical classification. Binary means we'll get C1, C2. Categorical means we'll get C1, C2, C3, CK. So depends on the application. I'll show one example, so case study. So this is the part of that KDD-CUP99 data set, because I can't consider that entire KDD-CUP99 data set because it will take a lot of time to evaluate. So that's why I took small part of KDD-CUP99 data set. So this is the data set, and this is the network data received, let us assume at 9:20 a.m. or maybe this is the data received after that, and this is the record received network, and this is the network data we received, and label, this is already available. The data is normal. The data is normal. There is no attack here, and there is a attack here, Neptune type of attack, and there is a attack type Neptune here. There is a attack type Neptune, and there is no attack here. There is no attack here. I'm taking binary classification. So we have attack and we don't have attack. So the either normal or maybe not bad attack, bad attack or Neptune attack, one type of attack. So now what happens? So this is the data received. This is up to 11:30. Let us assume. So this is 11:45. Around 11:45, I received this data in my network. So X1 value, X1, X2, actually some names are given in the data set. So those who are interested, you can go through that data set for the headings of X1, X2, X6. So just for understanding easily, I'm assuming name of the data label, input features are X1, X2, X3, I'm assuming. Now these are the data received in the network, 255 for X1 value, X2 value, like that. So now I want to classify whether the data is either normal data or maybe a malicious data. That means some type of attack is possible, or maybe normal data. This I have to classify by using Bayesian classifier, what we done just now. Now what we have to do is, we have to find probability of normal given X. Just now I told this numerator will change depends on the classification. So if we consider only two classes, binary classification, so here we have normal and one more type of attack, that is called Neptune. Suppose if we have more type of attacks, then it will change. So first we have to find probability of normal given X. X is nothing but all these features. So 255, 0.04, 0.08004. This is the data given, so that we have to consider for the denominator, and we have to find the probabilities. What is the probability of normal from the data set? So out of 10 records, six records having normal classification, and what is probability of X given normal? 1/7 from the data set available. Similarly, probability of X2 given normal. Like that, we have to find all the probabilities, and the value is this one. Similarly, we have to find probability of Neptune given X. So whatever features we have to consider as it is. The type of attack is different here. Other class, this is C1, this is C2. We have two types of attack only. One is normal attack, one is malicious attack. So for this, we have to find the probabilities. I got the probability 18/2430. So this we know how to calculate the probabilities. Now out of this, we have to find the maximum probability. So argmax, we have class normal, we have class Neptune, and probability of normal given X. X is common, that is the futures or maybe all the label, input futures, or we can call it as attributes. And one more PR probability, probability of Neptune given X, and these probabilities we calculated. So this is the maximum value. So out of these two probabilities, maximum value, this one, argmax means this maximum value corresponding to which class? This maximum value corresponding to Neptune attack. So that's why the final classification is this one. So the final classification. So that means there is an attack here, possibility is there immediately. So intuition detection system identified there is an attack here by using machine learning algorithm. So immediately system admin or maybe administrator will take immediate action. So based on that, we'll go for further step. So at least we identified there is a possibility for attack based on this network data. And immediately, obviously, you will get some alarm kind of thing, or maybe some siren kind of thing for intimation, or maybe some red alert. Immediately, they will go for further step. So that's why machine learning is very, very helpful to identify this type of attack. Immediately, based on that, we'll go for further step. So that's why here we just discussed what is Bayes theorem, how we got Bayes theorem also we discussed, and based on that we derived Bayes classifier that is called Bayes intuition classifier like this. So this is a simple data set I consider and I apply for the given data set. And the same thing we can apply for entire data set. If you have a data set with 10,000 records or 20,000 records also, there is no issue. Whenever we give new data, immediately we can classify the label or we can classify the output, whether Neptune attack or maybe some other type of attack. So many attacks are there. If we go through the data set, we can find so many types of attacks. So based on the input data, it will classify automatically. If the label is normal, there is no issue. So there is no attack going to happen. That's why we can classify directly normal like that. So evaluation also we can do by using confusion matrix. So because of time factor, we'll move to the next one. So this is a simple flow chart for a intuition detection system. So we have a KDD 99 cup data set. I already shown the resource for downloading this website data set, and we have to collect the data from the data set, and we have to pre-process if any data is missing or if you want to fill something. We have to go for pre-processing by using exploratory data analysis. We can do this one, and we have to classification of filter data and Navier's Bayes classifier. We have to apply. Finally, we will get output, and we have to evaluate based on that. Suppose the accuracy is 99% for the Navier's Bayes classifier, we can deploy for the application. If the accuracy is, let us assume, 30%, then we have to try other algorithm instead of Navier's Bayes. We can try, let us assume, KNN algorithm or decision tree or maybe random forest or maybe CNN, etc. Maybe whichever algorithm is available for supervised, you try to apply, and whichever algorithm will get more accuracy, that we can deploy for the application. So that's why evaluation is very, very important for any machine learning algorithm. Without evaluation, we can't deploy to the application. What happens if you deploy without evaluation? Instead of COVID positive patient having, then it will detect negative. Instead of negative, it will detect positive. Then it is a very, very serious issue. Because of that reason, if the evaluation or accuracy is 99, 98, etc., so obviously it is very good accuracy, then we can deploy. If we are not checking accuracy, we don't know whether 99 or 10 or 20, we don't know. So after checking accuracy only, then we can go for deploy to the application. So that's why evaluation as well as selection of model is very, very important for any application. So this I will skip. So here, whatever we done just now, Bayes and classifier, we can apply for machine learning one more application that is called email classification. Whenever we receive mails, the mail may, can be either spam or not spam, or we can call it as a ham. Not spam is nothing but ham, H-A-M. So obviously spam mails having some type of some kind of information, so possibility for attacking or maybe possibility for injecting the virus to the computer or maybe a server, etc. So that's why in general non-spam mails we won't open. If you open also, don't click that links provided by the sender. So that's why in general it will go to the spam, and after that in general most of them we won't check this one. So only non-spam mails we are going to check, and based on that we can extract the information. So this how it possible means by using machine learning model. So just now we discussed Bayes in model. So by using that we can classify whenever we receive any mail whether the mail is either spam or not spam, or we can call it as a ham. So this is done by using machine learning model that is called what we discussed, Bayes in classifier. So email fraud is a cyber terrorism. This is also one of the application in cyber security. This we can do by using Bayes in classifier, what we discussed just now. So if you are looking for data set for email spam detection, you can go for this data set, Coggle data set, or maybe UCI machine learning repository data set. You can find number of data sets here, I already said, maybe, or you can go for Coggle or GitHub repository, where you can find spam collection data set. And considering this, we can go for classification of whether the mail received is spam or ham. So this is the training data, and whenever if you go for learning, after that, whenever if you receive any new mail, let us assume the mail is like this: hello, please pay 20,000 and receive 2 crores money immediately, and this is your cash prize. Like that, we use to receive mails. So based on this email content, immediately it will classify this type of mails as spam mails. How it possible? Because already we have data set where this type of information is available only for spam mails. That's why automatically our Bayesian classifier or any machine learning algorithm will classify directly. So this data is a spam mail automatically. In general, spam means we are not going to open. There is no data we are going to lose here. So that type of applications we are going to apply that machine learning model what we applied just now for the KDDCup 99 data set for intrusion detection system. So here you can see, if you are looking for publication, this is published in Elsevier. So machine learning for email spam filtering, so review approaches and research problems, everything you can find if you are those who are looking for a research kind of publications. So there you can find detailed information, because in session not possible to discuss all those things, so we have very less time, out of it so many technical issues also. So just if you are interested, you can go through these publications in the Elsevier or Springer standard journals, maybe Scopus Index or SCA Index journals. You can download and you can go through that, whatever we discussed, same thing you can find, but the models are different. Depends on the accuracy, they will choose finally this model is best, or maybe they are going to introduce any new model also, possibility is there. Maybe here also you can see proposed efficient algorithm to filter the spam using machine learning techniques. So this is a cyber terrorism for classification of spam. So this we can do, classify by using machine learning techniques. So of course we can apply decision trees. So here we don't have time, just I'll skip these algorithms, not required. So this random forest, all those things, and the regression also I will skip because we have less time. I'll go to the things I have to explain, but time factor. So because of time factor, rest of the applications of cyber security by using machine learning I skip. So I will move to the image processing application for the cyber security. So you can see here, so I explained clearly what is Bayes theorem, how we derived, and how we derived Bayes in classifier, that is called intrusion, and how we applied for our cyber security application for intrusion detection system, and same thing how we can apply for email spam detection also, even how we can apply for medical classification like COVID-19 positive or not, like that. For any number of applications we can apply same model, only thing is data set is different. Similarly we have other concepts, regression, all those things. So we take that, it will not possible to cover this image processing, so just I skip that one. We'll move to the next concept, image processing for cyber security. You can see here, when you come to the cyber security goals, so confidentiality also one of the goal. What is the meaning of confidentiality? Whenever if I'm sending, this is the sender, let us assume this is the receiver. So whenever if I'm sending some message to the receiver, obviously third person cannot see the message, so this is called encryption. So we are, and after that decryption we can see the message, what is the message sent by the sender. So this we can do by using image processing applications also. Of course we have cryptography, etc., but here we are using image processing for cyber security applications in such a way that how to hide the information, based on that how receiver can receive the message and how we can reveal the data, and based on that what he will do further. So this comes under confidentiality. This is one of the major goal of cyber security, and this goal we can achieve by using some of the image processing applications that we will see now. So image processing fundamentals, I will tell you only one simple definition, later I'll move to the direct application. The image is nothing but matrix. I think almost all the participants studied matrices in lower classes. Whenever if I take here, I will write here, you can see here, so this is nothing but image. So whenever if I take matrix is nothing but image. Whenever if I take face or maybe any other object, if you want to represent image mathematically, we have to go for matrix. And what is the indication of the elements of the matrix? So this indicates color of a image. So whenever if we take matrix, so this is nothing but matrix entries, and this is nothing but color of a image. Whenever if I give input as an image, automatically it will convert to the digital form in matrix form. Then each color it will take automatically the values from 0 to 255, depends on the size of, bit image, 3-bit image or 8-bit image, we have different types of images. So automatically the color value will assume for further processing. So that's why image representation we can do by using matrix, and the values of the matrix indicates color or intensity value of an image. This will take an automatically program. No need to enter what is the value of color. Just our aim is to give the input as image, then automatically it will convert into matrix. Then it will go for image pre-processing, post-processing. Based on that, you'll go for final object of the image. So we have different types of image that we believe it. Now here we are going to see the one goal of cyber security, that is called confidentiality, that we can achieve by using cryptography, image technography. But we are talking about image processing, that's why we are going to use image technography. So the concept of image technography is just how to hide the information inside the image, and after decoding the receiver can see what message received from the senders. So that is the image technography. Just we have to hide the information, but no one can see. Even most of them don't know what is inside the image because difficult to identify. So this we can do by using image technography. There are so many technography tools are available in online also. I will show some of the image technography online tools also, so that you can understand how we are going to apply for our cyber security applications also. So here in image steganography, this is the basic idea. So we have normal image and we have secret message. Let us assume this is the image and we have secret message. And what we have to do, we have to hide the secret message in the normal image, and finally we'll get this output image. So in this image, message is hidden. So no one can see the message, what is inside, only receiver can see. So this is called stego image or steganographed image. So by using stego image analysis, we can see what message inside this image, or we can call it as a decoding message. We can see the message exactly. So, but here difficult to identify what is inside here. So here you can see the flow chart also. So we have a file and we have a secret message. File is nothing but image. And finally, we have to communicate through proper channel. And after decoder, the secret message we can reveal. So based on that, we can see what message sent by the sender. Suppose here the message is CSC, and this which is hidden in the image, no one can see what is the message hidden in the image, but only after decoding receiver can only see the message is CSC. So this is called steganography. So, or we can call it as a stego image analysis. By using that, we can see the hidden image message. So this is the steganography, means we are hiding message inside the image, and stego analysis means we can see the hidden message. That means we can decode the. And this is a basic idea, image steganography. So here we are looking for least significant bit technology. There we are changing the last bit. So this is called least significant bit. This is the most significant bit binary if I take any pixel value or color value. So this value we are going to change. If you change this value with the given message, whatever message we have, this we have to convert into ASCII value, and all the pixel values of the image of LSB value we are changing with this message. Based on that, there is no change in the color much. Because of that reason, we are changing only least significant bit. Suppose if I'm trying to change the most significant bit, there is a huge change. If you see here, whenever if I'm trying to change a most significant bit here, 255, if I'm trying to change MSB value, it is changed to 127. See how much difference. If you see the difference in the intensity value, the color also will change automatically. But when you see here, if I'm trying to change least significant bit, there is very less difference in the encoded image, obviously. So there is no color change in the image. Because of that reason, we are applying LSB technique, least significant bit technique. We are applying there. We are trying to change the last bit of the image pixels is changed to the message as values. Based on that, so we can hide the message inside the image, and we can decode. Then we can see exactly what is inside. So these are the ASCII values. So this I will skip because of time constraint. So I'll move to the image steganography tools. These are all available in the online. So I will show some examples also. You can see this is one of the image steganography tool, STYLEXUX. So that you can type in Google, you can find. Here we have two buttons here. One is encode button and one is decode button. When you press encode button, we have to choose a file here. So whatever file, image, file means here image. So whatever it may be extension, you can choose the image file. And we have to enter the message here. Let us assume the secret message. The secret message is, let us assume, ABBS. So I'm assuming the secret message is ABBS. This is the secret message what I'm trying to send to the receiver. I choose an image, and after that, I'm entering the secret message. Now, after that, what we have to do, we have to go to the decode button. So here we have a decode button. So this we have to do, we have to take. and we have to choose the file what we send, and after that we can identify. So the message, hidden message, is APPS. So some messages I typed here, welcome to GRIT. So this was done a long back, last month for some GRIT engineering college. But I am assuming here APPS message, so that's why. So I will get output after decoding. I will get. So same, you can see. So this is the original image. Even if you take in a Stigo image also, there is no change, but we are able to see the output. So you can see here. So finally, we are getting a decoded message, whatever decoded message that we get here, welcome to GRIT or welcome to ABPSC, like that. So this is called steganography. So we have an input image, we are typing the message. This is online tool actually. So just we can input the image, we can type the secret message. So the message is hidden in the image, and after decoding, we can find what secret message sent by the sender. So after encoding, you see, after encode button, if you click, we can find the message, secret message. And if we take decoding, we'll get. And if you take one more thing, Stigo analysis with the key. So what is the meaning here? Means we can send the message with some password. Key is nothing but password. Suppose I want to send the message ABBSC and the key is 123. Whenever the receiver enter 123, then only he is able to see the message ABBSC. Otherwise he can't see. But previously what happens, there is no password. Directly after decoding, I'm able to see the receiver, sender's message. But when it come to this application, what we have to do, we have to enter the message, along with we have to make a key. This key we have to send to the receiver. Once if we enter key, or we can call it as a password, then only you can decode the message and you can see the secret message. So the reference is this one. This is a Elsevier journal, so Computers and Electrical Engineering. This is one of the top journal. Even I published fact factor 3. Something SEI indexed one. So there I referred this paper. So this is a basic idea, and based on that we can decode the message. Suppose if you take online tool PELOG, this is the online tool. You can type in Google, you can find this PELOG. Here what happens, we have to select the image. You can see here, select a image. So some image we selected, whatever it may be image, and enter encryption password. Here I have to enter the password. My password is 123. And here enter the secret message. The secret message is, let us assume, Bangalore. Message Bangalore. So what is the difference between previous online tool, this online tool? Previous online tool, there is no password, but here we have password. That's why this is published in Elsevier journal. Now here, when you come to the decoding, whatever image we selected that we saved in the desktop, that we have to browse, we have to select that one, and we have to enter the password here, whatever password we entered here, same thing. And we have to we will get the message here, whatever message sender sent, that we'll get here. So output will get Bangalore, like this. So that the main difference between previous steganography tool online tool, here we have a password, or we can call it as a key, but previously we don't have key. But this is more secure. If you have password, obviously this is more secure when compared to the previous one. So let us assume, if I type, let us assume the password is EC1234 and the message is something. After entering the password, we can find the message here. After decoding, we can find the message, and I'm able to see here. So images also, there is no change. We are difficult to identify what is the inside message, because there is no color change in the image, because we are looking for least significant bit change. Suppose by mistake I entered the password, instead of ECE123 I entered CSC123, then obviously you won't get any message. Instead of that, you'll get password is invalid. So that's why key is very, very important. So based on that, we can decode the message and we are able to see. So that's why key also we should know. That's why this is more secure stego analysis or steganographed image when compared to the without key. That's why most of the applications we are using this steganography tool, so that we can send the message very secretly inside the image, and after giving the password, then only we are able to see the hidden message. And we have one more image processing application for cyber security. I think everyone used to see this. I can call it as a nonsense only, because every time, whenever if I'm trying to do something, you will get this type of captures. So most of the time, even we are completed PhDs or masters, difficult to enter proper captures. Why? Means that letters are a little bit not proper, so we have to enter 2-3 times, then only it will match. Finally we can be able to enter our Gmail login, or maybe especially banks logins, this is mandatory. Most of the banks having this password. So first question is, why they have to put this one? So there is a question. Even I used to get this question. After done some literature survey on captures, I came to know this is the logic. The main reason for this capture is, so to avoid, so our machine is doing the logging. So whenever if I take a Gmail, maybe automatic machines, we have robots we have. So maybe robots also can do login of my passport, I mean log Gmail or maybe some bank. So because of that reason, so to verify whether human is operating the login or maybe machine is operating the login. So machine is difficult to identify this type of captures. That's why human means we can identify after one or two successful failures only. Difficult to go for first time attempt successful. Because of that reason only this captures comes to the picture. So this is completely automated public turning test to tell to the computers human is operating the login details. Otherwise, some machine or maybe some robot is operating means, so it is difficult, maybe possibility for data breaching. Because of that reason, this comes to the picture. Can you imagine this captcha actually having a company previously recaptcha? Recaptcha is the name of the company. So now what happens, this Google acquires this recaptcha with $50 billion. Now this is handover by Google, not recaptcha. Recaptcha is the actual company, so they only introduced this captcha. Now what happens is Google acquires this recaptcha by paying $50 billion. You can imagine $50 billion just for entering the images or just for entering the data, capture data, this much they are paying. That means this many security applications we have, because of that reason captchas plays a very very vital role. Most of them don't know why we are entering these captchas. It will disturb like anything, but these are the main reason. By introducing these captures, make sure that human is operating the login details or human is operating the system, all those things to find properly, that's why captures are introduced. But we are also not able to do successfully first attempt. Most of the time we have to do 2-3 times attempts. Finally, it is successful. Based on that, we can go for web page or maybe our login details or login page. But here now the question is how image processing come to the picture here. So this is one of the main cyber security application. So why means whenever if we enter capture, yes. So how machine will recognize? What happens here? Machine learning comes to the picture by using machine learning techniques that we can call it as a deep learning. So it will convert into proper text, then it will identify. So both are equal, then it will allow inside the login credentials, I mean login page, then we can go for further step. You can see here, most of the letters difficult to identify what is exactly. So you see, if you see here, it is difficult to identify these captures. So we are only not able to identify after entering how system will identify directly. So for that, so we have to go for some machine learning techniques. Based on that, it will identify, then it will match with the database. Whenever both are matching, then it will allow your captcha is successful. Otherwise, captcha is failure. Again, you have to enter one more, re-enter, recapture like that. So for that, we have to go for image processing. So here we have image processing techniques. This is the input image. After doing properly, finally, we can identify it. Here you can see, this is the input image. We identified the image is translated to finally small proper text, that is YEM. By 4, otherwise difficult to identify. For this, we can go for either image processing techniques or we can go for machine learning or deep learning techniques also. So here, this algorithm deals with the image processing, and this algorithm deals with the neural networks. By using neural networks, we can classify whether the capture value is 7 or not. So input layer, these are all processing layers. Finally, it will activate 7. The input is 7 here. You can see here, this is the image. So after applying input image, whatever I entered, let us assume, so hi, this is the capture text. So how it will recognize after applying this deep learning model? So finally, it will detect the messages HAI. So it will match with database and both are equal. Then we can enter inside your login credentials or login page. Then we can go for further step. So for this type of solving captures also, we are using machine learning or we can call it as a deep learning techniques, and image processing also we are applying, because input only image, we have to process the image. Further that, we have to go for further step. So for this also, we can go for image processing techniques as well as deep learning techniques for identify the captures, and based on that we can go for inside the login credentials. So this is one of the most important applications under cyber security to minimize the unnecessary attacks or to minimize the attacking our login credentials. Even if we take human diagnosis medical systems also, we can apply our machine learning algorithms. Yeah,
professor, just we can take another 5 minutes time to wind up.
No issue, no, sir. Okay. Yeah. Even I have to have that right. Yeah, fine. That's why I skipped some of the slides. So now when you come to the one more application here, human health diagnosis medical system. So here also we are applying machine learning, because this is also one of the service sector and very, very important for all the human beings. So here what happens whenever if we type some symptoms, let's assume I type the symptoms as fever, let us assume, or maybe headache, etc. Automatically it will recommend the doctor. So which doctor is nearer to you, and she or he is specialized for handling this type of symptoms directly.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Yes.
Hello, sir.
Sir, so there me, is sir? A you have said it about the captcha. There is another yes, one sir. That is I am an human instead of captcha they are using nowadays. What is that yes, being replaced for the captcha?
What is that? Sir, can you tell me one second?
Last one, you told something.
Yes, sir. Nowadays, instead of using the captcha, they are saying that tick mark on the I am a human instead of captcha. So
yeah, that is also correct.
Is it a replacement? Is it a replacement of captcha?
That is not replacement. So that is also one type of security application only. Captchas also still most of the web pages they are using. Some of the web pages are using that application also. So depends on.
And if I mark the tick mark, then
because
then,
what happens? This captcha is not that much user friendly. Maybe because.
If I make the tick mark,
so
then
make sure that some human being is operating. That is. Yeah, correct, sir. Tick mark, that is also one type of security application. Based on that, we can identify it. So some human is operating the system instead of some automatic operation or maybe some robo like that. So that is also available.
It's now, that is available means the captcha is replaced by this one or something is.
No, not replaced. Some are using captcha, some are using this one, sir. There is no replacement like that. Depends on their convenience. They are using captchas. Maybe some are using this one like that. So because the captchas are actually irritating, maybe because of that reason, some are using this one also. Ticking means there is no, it's the easy process, but captchas means it will irritate like anything. So that's why most of the Google application services, they are using captchas only, sir. You can check it. Those who are having service from the Google, they are using captchas only because they are providing that free of cost, maybe with less amount. Maybe others, maybe they are using what you said, the ticking also.
Okay.
So coming to here, when you come to the one more service sector application, when you come to the recommendation, if you type some symptoms automatically, doctor will recommend to you. And based on that, we can go for testing. This is one kind of recommendation system by using machine learning algorithms, what we discussed, Bayesian classifier. By using Bayesian classifier, we can make a training that data. Already we have data set with symptoms followed by specialist doctors. And whenever you give new symptom, automatically it will recommend the doctor. So this is one of the major application in the service sector of machine learning. Based on that, you'll get recommendation of doctor. Not only this one, if you take movie recommendation also, you can do by using machine learning algorithms, or you can go for product recommendation. These are all comes under service sector only. So all those recommendation we can do by using machine learning algorithm, what we discussed, Bayesian classifier. Maybe other algorithms also we can apply, but today we discussed Bayesian classifier that is applicable for all these applications. And these are the textbooks, but initially I said we have very, very less number of resources are available for machine learning for cybersecurity. Even after I done a lot of literature survey for this, FDP, previously I gave so many FDPs on machine learning for cybersecurity. I found only 2-3 textbooks only. So hands-on machine learning for cybersecurity and second one, maybe I found this YouTube resource. This is one of the best YouTube resource for machine learning for cybersecurity. You can find so many lectures here. That is very, very interesting how machine learning for cybersecurity. So that the pronunciation is difficult to understand. You can go for subtitles and you can understand how it is useful for cybersecurity. Whatever I discussed, almost it will reflect there also, but still you can find so many other applications because we have very less time. But there, if you go through that YouTube channel, you can find so many applications. You can type in YouTube search. So Purdue University machine learning for cybersecurity, you can find all those things. So if you have any queries, I'm happy to answer. So so because of time constraints, some of the concepts I skip. Still, I can take one more hour to complete, but because of time factor, I skip some of the concepts. But the main concepts I covered. So regression I skipped because of less time, and we got between some disturbances of technical issues also. But I think understood what is machine learning basics, cybersecurity basics, and how machine learning algorithm applicable for cybersecurity, and how what is image processing introduction and how it is applicable for cybersecurity application of confidentiality, how to hide the image message and online tools also explained briefly.
Sir, only one question, sir. Dr. Somshekhar.
Yes,
my name is Shankar, sir. Regarding that steganography slide, sir, you showed that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
PASCII, this one encoding and private key. Steganography. Question regarding steganography.
Your voice is not clear, sir.
Steganography. Yes, steganography. In that, if you can please go to that slide after the after giving the ENCO
Steganography means the basic idea is we have input image, each pixel value we have to replace. For example, this is a pixel value, let us assume 1 1 1, and the message what we are going to send there also we have as
okay.
So your voice is not clear, so I think I'm getting with some noise. Noise means not clear. One second. Tell me, sir, now I think it's clear a little bit. I'll move, sir, just now.
That slide, sir, if you go to that slide showing steganography, after giving the key,
this one,
the
sir,
private key, the steganography, previous, sir, previous encoding message and previous, sir. Okay. Was there any change in the original image and the final image, sir? I mean, was there
I understood, sir. So
yes, sir, what are the message in the hidden? The key, yes. And you gave so the key and the encoding.
Correct. Are you able to see original image, sir?
Yes, sir, yes. Original image, I'm able to.
Now, this is the hidden image. Is there any difference? Maybe difficult to identify, actually. There is not much difference. The reason is, so whenever the input values are 255, let us assume input image, after using least significant bit, that means last bit we are changing, the value becomes maybe 254 or 253. Whenever if one value changing, it won't show much effect in the image color. So because of that reason, the image, original image and decoded image looks like same only. That's why the unauthorized person difficult to identify, is there any something in the image like that. Suppose if I'm looking for most significant bit, what happens? This is the original image, and if you go for encoded, it becomes, let us assume 100. Then obviously the color will change. Instead of green color, it becomes red color maybe. So that's why we can identify something is there inside the image. So that's why this we are not going to apply. That's why we are applying LSD technique.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So there is no change, sir.
Exactly. But there should be a significant change in that encode. Okay, passkey. That least significant. Okay, sir.
There is no much sense, sir.
Okay.
Any other questions? Any queries from the participants? Otherwise, we'll conclude the session.
Yeah,
because
yes, sir.
At 2:30, we are
going. Significant, then problem. You can identify something is there inside image.
At 2:30, we are going to have another session. We have very less time for lunch, so we'll take a quick lunch break. So I thank Professor Somashekar for the useful and informative session on machine learning.
Thank you, sir.
For the